analysis of simple trusses. So first, before that, you should know what is truss. Okay, so truss is a member. Okay, it is a type of structure in which all the members are subjected to only compression and tension. Okay, so there will not be any moment. Suppose I'll draw one simple truss here. Okay, so this is a simple truss which I'm going to draw. So this is a truss. I hope you have seen these type of structures like in railway bridges, okay? And those type of structures, we call them as the trusses. Here, all these joints, whatever you are seeing, they are actually a pinned joints. Means they can means they are not rigid, okay? So they are pinned one. Like pinned, I have shown example, like they will be held like this, okay? So they can rotate, okay? In short, but here, as they are hinged, so and they are not actually a fixed condition. So what will happen? So in these members, only compression and tension will be there. No moment. So compression and tension means if I take one member and to this member, either this member will be either in compression. Okay, if the load is towards the member, then we call it as compression. Okay, or it might be in tension. Or it might be in tension like this. Okay, so only these two are possible in members. Okay, so either they will be in compression or tension. So this is compression or this is tension. So there will not be any moment in the any of the members. Such type of structures we call them as a trusses. Okay, this is one simple truss. Here first we need to understand whether this structure or whether this structure that is truss is stable or unstable. So we have a formula to calculate whether the structure is stable or not, that is truss is stable or not, that is 2J minus 3. This is a simple formula. Based on this, we will able to know whether the given truss is stable or unstable. Okay, so how we calculate? So where M is the number of members, okay, where M is the number of members, M is equals to number of members. Number of members, okay, where J is the number of joints, number of joints. So now if I take this member only, how many joints I find? So there is one joint here, two joint, three joint, four joint, five joints, right? So how many joints are there? Five joints. So if I write 5 into 2, that is 2J, right? So 2J, I'll write it as 2 into number of joints, that is 5 minus 3, how much I should get? 7. And how many members are there here? Calculate. This is first member, this is second member, this is third, 4, 5, 6, 7. How many members are there? 7 members are there. And even if I calculate using this 2J minus 3 also, I am getting 7. So both are 7, right? So members are also 7. And if I calculate from the joints, I am also getting members equals to 7. If both are equal, right hand and left hand, then we call them as a stable structures. How we have got this formula, that is very much important. Okay, so if you understood this, how we have got this M equals to 2J minus 3, then you will never forget this formula. Okay, don't remember the formula, just follow what I am saying now. Okay, so if I draw first 3 points, okay, for to creating the same truss, what I am doing? So first I am taking these 3 joints, first joint, second joint and third joint, and now I am joining these 3. Now I am joining for this one joint. How many members I require? 2 members. Okay, I'll take one more joint here. For every one joint next afterwards, I require how many members? 2 members. For every one joint, how many members I require? 2 members. But initially what happened? For first 3, how much I should have got? According to this one, 6 members I should have got. Correct? So that is, for every one joint, how many members I require? Members required is equals to, for every joint, how many members are required? 2 members. But for first 3 members, for first 3 joints, how many members are got? Only 3 members instead of 6, right? So that's why I am reducing 3 here. So this is how we have got this equation. Okay, that is M is equals to 2J minus 3. Hope all of you have understood this. Okay, so next we'll go to what we call when this equation doesn't satisfy. Okay, so when M is not equals to 3, that is m is not equals to 2j minus 3, then what we call them. Okay, suppose I'll draw one diagram here. Okay, so I'll draw one diagram here. So here this is a truss, consider this as a truss. Okay, a simple example I am taking. So this is a truss and which is resting on a supports, and in this one calculate how many members are there. How many members are there here in this member, in this truss? Number of members is equals to 4. And how many joints are there? Joints is equals to, how many joints are there? 1 joint, 2 joint, 3 joint, 4 joint. 4 joints are there. Okay. Now if I substitute in this equation, so what I get? 4 is equals to 2 into 4 minus 3. It should be there. But what is happening? 4 is equals to 4 to the 8 minus 3, 5, which is not equal. Which is not equal. How many extra, how many is there? That is, 1 is the difference. 1 is difference. Means, if I calculate how many members are required for 4 joint, m is equals to, how many members are required to make it a perfect? 5. But how many I have? 4. So therefore, number of extra members required. Extra member required. How much it is? Which is equals to 1. Here, 1 member is less. Here, 1 member is less than the actually stable structure. So then what we call it as a, we call such type of structures as deficit. We call them as a deficit or unstable. So what we have to do now, we have to add this one extra member. If I add one extra member here, then it will become a stable. If this member is not there, then it will become a deficit. So we'll add one member so that it will become a stable structure. If I add one more, I can add even one more here also like this. So if I add one more, what will happen? Now we'll check for this condition. Okay. So if I check for this condition, how many members are there here? 1, 2, 3, 4 members are there. 5, 6. This is not a joint. Okay. This is not a joint. So members we have? Total 6 members. How many joints we have? Joint I have not changed. Only 4 joints. 1, 2, 3, 4 joints are there. This is not a joint. Again I am saying, this is not a joint. Okay. 4 joints are there. 6 members are there. If I substitute here, m is equals to 2j minus 3. That is 2 into 4 minus 3. That I should have got 5 members. But how many members are there? Extra. For 4 joints, how many members we require? 5 members. But how many I have provided? 6. This one extra member, how many extra members we have provided? We have provided 1 extra member. Correct? Such type of structures, we call them as a, or trusses, we call them as a redundant truss. This type of extra member, right? So this we call it as a redundant member. Redundant member. Always we prefer redundant structures. Okay, not unstable one. Unstable means this is the unstable. This is unstable. We don't prefer such structures. Why? Because if I apply any load here, what will happen? This will tilt and fall off. Imagine, because there is no support, all these are pinned only. All these are pinned. So if I apply any load, so it will fall off. Whereas if I provide one structure or one extra member here, what will happen? This will hold the member. Correct? And even it will take the load. So such type of structures we call them as stable. Whereas if I provide one more here, if I provide one more, what will happen? So even though this member fails, so this member will help the structure to hold. Okay, so that's why we always prefer redundant members. So how we can solve these trusses, right? So suppose if I take one simple truss, I'll take this simple truss and I want to find out the forces that are coming on this truss. The forces, suppose if I am applying some force here, what are the forces that are coming on the truss? That we need to find out, right? So for that we know these trusses, either they will carry compression or tension. These trusses will not carry any movement, right? So first step, what is the first step to calculate the forces in the member? Step one is calculate the support reactions. These are the supports. First we need to calculate support reactions. This is what? Horizontal at A. This is vertical at A, and this is horizontal at A, and this is vertical at B. This is the first step. First step is to calculate the कैलकुलेट सपोर्ट रिएक्शन. कैलकुलेट सपोर्ट रिएक्शन, दिस इज द फर्स्ट स्टेप. सो हाउ यू कैलकुलेट, यू कंसिडर दिस होल ट्रस एज अ बीम फर्स्ट. ओके, consider this whole truss as a beam, and whatever you have done in the previous classes, same thing, by using same methods you find out HA, VA and VB. This is the first step. And next step, step 2, we have two methods here. One is calculation of the members, forces in members can be calculated by two methods. Okay, first one can be calculated by two methods. First one is joint method. Second one is section. Okay, it is section method. Or we also call it as method of section. Okay, section method, method of section. Okay, section method. So in the first one, what we do, we take this one small joint. So what are the forces that are coming here? If I take this first joint, okay, so if I take this first joint, so what are the members are there here? These are the members, one force is there, and then there is one member. So if I call it as A, B, C, D, okay, so at joint D, what are the forces that might be there? One will be there is a force in member CD, or I call it as DC, and one more there might be there, that is force in member DA. Correct? So if I take this joint, I know there are three forces, and then we can apply the equilibrium equation, that is summation of Fx equals to 0 and summation of Fy is equals to 0. By applying these two, I can calculate force in DC and force in member DA. Correct? I am assuming, if I am showing this symbol towards the joint, then it means that I am assuming the member is in compression. We'll check it, okay? And if I am showing it away from the member, then the member is in tension, okay? So that we'll see. Next method is method of section. So what we'll do in method of joints, we'll take all such joints first one by one. Like I'll come to this one and I'll draw this, and I've already calculated this FDC, and I'll assume all other, and then again I'll use summation of Fx equals to 0 and summation of Fy equals to 0. We'll keep on doing to all the structures, all the joints, until we find the forces in all the given members. Okay, this is by method of joints. So in method of sections, what we'll do, we'll cut this whole truss into sections, and then we try to solve it. We'll discuss about this method of sections when we'll be dealing with that. So before going to that, so you need to understand, there are some simple tricks that are available here. Okay, there are some simple tricks that are available so that we can eliminate some of the members which carry zero forces. By looking at those members only, we can be easily able to say that in this member there is no force at all. First one, okay, in method of joints, this is very much important. If you are able to find out in which members the force is zero, then it will be very easy for you to calculate the remaining forces in the members. Remaining member forces. So suppose consider this is one joint, okay, at which there are two members are there, and there is also one more member which is connected here. Okay, so consider this is force in member 1, force in member 2, and force in member 3. Okay, and as you are seeing, the two members are in collinear, means they are in same line. Okay, so they are in same line, whatever the force is coming there in this member, that will be transferred to this member directly. Will you accept? If I take this some joint O, whatever the force is coming in this member, it will be taken directly. Like if I take this pen, if I take these two pens, okay, two pens which are acting, like, so if there is one force which is coming here, this force will be carried by this one, right? So the force is coming here, that will be compensated by this. So if there is one more member here, so this member will not carry any force at all, because the force which is coming in this, that will be carried by this, so this member will remain free. right? So therefore this member will carry zero force. So we can say that this member, the force in the member 3 is directly zero. Okay, so either it may be perpendicular or even the member may be like this also. Okay, so if this is the point and if the member is somewhere here also, like this is F1 and this is F2, and suppose there is one more member 3, okay, the force in member 1 will be compensated by force in will be compensated by this member 2 only. The force which is there in the member 1 will be compensated by force in the member 2 because they are collinear, they are in same line. But this one is not in collinear, right? So this is some other member. So means the force in this third member will be zero. This is the first method that you have to remember. Okay, this is the first method that you have to remember. Second one. Suppose if there are two members which are there here, say suppose this is force this is member 1 and let me call this as member 2. And there is no other external force applied on these two members. Okay, there is no other external force applied on these members such that here, not here. So, like in this case, okay, so consider this as F1, that is force in member 1, and this as force in member 2. Suppose the given force is here. Is there any force that is applied on this member or this joint? Is there any force here that is applied at this joint? No. In such cases, we take these two as zero directly. In such cases, we take these two as zero. Or even like this also, if the members are somewhere like this also. This is F1, this is F2, that is force in member 1, force in member 2, and if there is no external force applied on this joint, then also we can directly say that the force in these two members is directly zero. You understood these two concepts? Have you understood these two concepts? Any doubts in these two concepts? Okay, so third one, if two members are acting in a collinear, suppose this is member 1, I'll call it as force in the member 1, and if this is member 2, force in the member 2. And if two members are collinear and there is no other member and there is no external force at all. Okay, if two members are collinear and no external force and no other member is acting or present in this joint, then we can directly say that the force in these two members is directly equals to zero. So if you understood these three concepts, then we can go further. So before going to that, you should remember that, as I have said, the trusses are a type of structure in which the members will not carry any moment. Either the force in the member will be compression or tension. To make that, you need to remember there are two assumptions that we have made. Okay, to create a truss, we have made two assumptions. All the members are straight. Okay, so we have assumed that one is all the members, whatever they are there, they will be straight. Okay, they will not be bent. Okay, and the load is applied axially. This is the first assumption. Okay, all the members are straight and the load applied is axially. Okay, this is the first one. So why we have assumed all the members are straight only? Suppose if the member is not straight, if it is curving like this, if the member is bent like this, what will happen if I apply the load here and if I apply the load, what will happen? So the member will start acting in this point. Okay, and but actually neutral axis of the member will come somewhere here, then there is the distance d. So this d multiplied by the force, that will create a moment in the member. Okay, so that's why, so all the members should be straight and the load should be acted at the exactly axially at the neutral axis of the member, right? So therefore, so if there is a deflection in the member, that will create some moment in the member, so thereby whatever we have assumed in the truss, that is moment should not be present. Okay, moment should not be present. Whatever we have said, moment should be equal to zero. That will not come because there is force into distance that will create m is equal to f into d. Okay, so that's why the member should be straight and the force should be applied axially. Okay, second one, all the loads must be applied at the joint itself. Okay, second assumption what we have made is all the loads should be applied at the joint itself. Suppose if I take this member, or if I take this truss, all the forces or all the external loads that has to be applied either at the joints or at the support only. Either the force has to be applied at the joints or at the support itself. You are not allowed to apply the load somewhere on the member, because if you apply the load on the member, what will happen? This member will start bending. This member will start bending, and if it starts bending, what will happen? So there might be some forces like this. So that will create a moment. This is some deflection d. So then this is f. So f into d will create a moment. So then the whatever the thing we have assumed, truss. Okay, the truss moment should be equal to zero. That will not come into effect. So therefore, either you have to apply the moments or apply the forces either at joint you have to apply, or at where, or at supports. Okay, then only we can call this as a truss. Okay, so there is one more thing. All these points are pin jointed means they are held like something like this. Okay, so like this, they are held like this. They can rotate a bit. Okay, they can rotate a bit. And if instead of pin jointing, if I weld these joints, what it will become? It will become a frame. So if they are welded, they are not allowed to rotate. Okay, so if they are not allowed to rotate, what will happen? There comes moment. Okay, like if I take this example, this is whatever the structure you are seeing in your home, right? So the columns, so they are not they are rigid ones, they are not pin jointed. So means this will be always remain same. They are not allowed to rotate. If I apply the load, whole member will come something like this. So in such cases we call them as a frames. So in truss, members will not carry any moment, whereas in frames the member will carry moment. If the joints are welded or fixed, then we call it as a frame. You should understand these things.